Hi, this is your fitness coach Arjun, and today we are going to bust some myths and uncover some truths related to type 2 diabetes. We have been told that due to factors such as genetic predisposition, eating sugars and sweets, not exercising, excessive fat gain, one day we find diabetes knocking on our door since our blood glucose levels have shot up and out of the normal ranges. The reason they state, insulin can't work properly. Your blood sugar levels keep rising, hence more insulin is released and eventually tire the pancreas out, meaning the body makes less and less insulin. Henceforth, you are put on medication and taught to live with it for the rest of your life with an incurable disease. Now, we uncover the truth through the lens of functional medicine. Firstly, diabetes is a lifestyle disease and is caused by too much insulin. Not because absurdities like it can't work properly or there's not enough of it. I'll start with the why and get to the how in a second. In our times, we are surrounded by foods that are highly processed and refined, high in sugar, especially, and I would like to emphasize this, especially fructose. Why? Because fructose is only metabolized by the liver. So these foods, they are low in essential nutrients and high in calories, not forgetting the artificial additives, flavorings, and whatnot. Basically, things our body cannot recognize. The junk food club with high levels of stress and toxins contribute to this disease process. Now, especially if you have the genetics, this can actually exacerbate the process. In most cases, it's the lifestyle that leads to the problem, while in others, it could be entirely due to stress or toxicity alone. While, of course, there are other factors that could lead to type 2 diabetes as well, like other medications that can reduce insulin sensitivity as a side effect, or low energy due to hypothyroidism, adrenal fatigue, or hormonal imbalance, giving rise to cravings for refined carbs and causing a lower metabolism, and more. Now, let me give you a clear picture of the hows by explaining some of the major factors that contribute to type 2 diabetes. But before we go ahead, I would like to take a minute to quickly and very briefly describe normal metabolic functioning just so that you have a better understanding of what comes next. Okay, so after consuming a meal, let's say a pasta with veggies and a so-called healthy fruit juice, the food gets broken down in the gut and we obtain glucose, which crosses over into the bloodstream, giving us a sugar spike. In response to which, insulin gets secreted by the liver, acts more like a key to the insulin receptor on the cell, basically the lock on the cell, and helps unlocking the muscle and liver cells so that glucose can enter and replenish their glycogen, which is a storage form of energy, and thereafter the remaining glucose gets converted and stored as fat by the liver through the process of de novo lipogenesis. And blood glucose goes down over time because sugar goes into the cell, and we end up with the drop in blood glucose and a coincident drop in insulin. Then we end up with this period of time in between meals where the cells are using up the sugar that they bought on board. We may be diving into glycogen, and if this fast here lasts much longer, then we'll start breaking down stored fat and using them as fuel, courtesy to the hormone glucagon. And this is what normally happens. Now, starting off with the first factor, fructose, which has many names: high fructose corn syrup, natural corn syrup, isolated fructose, maize syrup, glucose syrup, tapioca syrup, and the list goes on. So fructose is only available to restore glycogen in the liver, and then very rapidly is used in order to start producing fats. So do you think, looking at the size of the liver, that it would need that much? So many people consuming fructose, knowingly or unknowingly, through basically junk foods and sugary drinks in their beginning, the blood sugar looks great. Their HbA1c looks great, but they are generating lots of fat, especially viscerally, resulting in a non-alcoholic fatty liver disease, which eventually spreads to the pancreas, affecting its function. And so sometimes this is actually the first step of metabolic dysfunction, and high intake of fructose combined with a high intake of glucose from things like refined grains, we end up with this double whammy. So this initial fattiness in the liver, which impairs its function, and we end up with the liver unable to respond optimally to the high blood sugar. And so insulin remains high, and the processive cycle of high insulin with the liver impairment over time forward fuels and perpetuates insulin resistance. Looking at excessive high glycemic carbs, we know that it's already contributing to excessive body fat and high levels of insulin, preventing the breakdown of stored fats. So the process of fat storage continues, leading on to the same outcome as in the case of fructose. And eventually, when you have a look at fasting blood glucose and hemoglobin A1C, unless you check fasting insulin, which is always left out, so there won't be any signs of this, and everything will seem normal because the pancreas are busy pumping out insulin to shove the glucose in the cells, and the poor liver is working very hard packing it all away. This stage of hyperinsulinemia is left undiagnosed. And this cascade continues for months and months and years until finally, after a decade, the day arrives when you see a rise in your fasting glucose and hemoglobin A1C, labeling you as a pre-diabetic. And it's just a matter of time before crossing into the clinical diagnosis of type 2 diabetes. What's happening here? We don't feel very well. We feel hungry, weak, and tired, and we are getting fatter. The cells are choking full of sugar, which brings me to the point where I would like to share with you all Dr. Fong's quote. He says, "On what planet does it make sense that a whole bunch of sugar in the blood is toxic to the lining of arteries, but a whole bunch of sugar internal to the cell is not toxic to the cell?" Lastly, toxins and stress. Starting with toxins that cause oxidative damage to the cell membranes, they interfere with enzymes that drive cellular metabolism, basically impairing ATP production. ATP, which is the energy currency of our body. It's not just about the burden on the liver. However, the experience of toxicity is unique to individuals. And then stress. One of the most important issues with regard to metabolic dysfunction is that stress hormones increase blood sugar and insulin demand completely separate from food, eventually leading up to the same chain of events. So I hope that I have helped you to see what's behind this notion that somehow one is a non-diabetic and then one magically becomes a pre-diabetic, and somehow that magically turns into diabetes. In part two, I will be helping you out with some ways using which you can get out of the mess, this vicious cycle, along with busting a few more myths. I hope you found this video helpful, and you have any suggestions or questions, then please put it in the comments section. Thank you for watching.